Hey Robot Makers, how are you doing? Hope you're having a good day so far. And Merry Christmas 2021. So let's get to unboxing, shall we? I'll also give you an update on Clustered Pie and some major updates I've had in that arena. So let's dive straight in. My name's Kevin. Come with me as we build robots, bring them to life with code, and have a whole load of fun along the way. And I think one of the things I'm going to get for Christmas this year is a new hub to plug all these different devices in. I've got all kinds of cameras and microphones and more cameras plugged in using these very cheap HDMI things, and they're not very good, if I'm honest, that they sort of let you down occasionally. So that's what I'm going to get, I've decided. Okay, so let's get to the unboxing, shall we? So you're probably wondering what on earth is underneath this this cover here. So I'll not keep you waiting very long to find that out. In fact, here we go. It's a robot vacuum cleaner. So you might have already have one of these in your household. I've not had one to date, and you would have thought, being a gadget freak, I would have had one of these, but I have not yet. So we've got one for the robot lab, and my daughter's also got one for university. So we've got two of these to have a play with. So we're going to learn about how this thing works. It is a robot, so this is why it's on the show today. We're going to look at some of the operations and features. I've even not opened this from the box yet, so this will be a proper live unboxing. We're going to look at how it does things like object avoidance, how it actually cleans and operates around the room, because this thing will choose a path, and there's some different options depending on which type of robot vacuum cleaner you get, and we'll have a look at what this one can do. And it also has this return to charge station, and that's something that I want to be able to enable on our robot, so that it can, when the battery is getting low, first of all it can detect the battery level, and then secondary it can return to the base. So let's just have a quick look at this thing. So this is a D-Bot. And it says there the model is an N79S. I think these were on special on Amazon on Black Friday. So I'm just going to open this up and we'll just have a quick peep inside of this. So like I said, there we go. I've not even unboxed this myself yet. So I've got the usual kind of things there. And here it is. So let's get over to our slides again and we can have a little bit more look at some of the things that this thing can do. So how in general do robot vacuum cleaners work? So you think a traditional vacuum cleaner is something that you have to just like manually move around the room with your little stick or whatever, and point the vacuum nozzle at the thing you want to clean. So these things obviously work a lot differently than that, and they're typically battery operated as well. They usually have two wheels, this sort of variety does as well. So I just open this out for a second and I'll show you what this has underneath. So this indeed does have two wheels there and there, and that bit on the top there is just like a little wheel to stop the wheels sort of dragging or falling over. They sense the environment and they have a number of range finders. Sometimes it's infrared, sometimes it is ultrasonic, or if it's the high-end ones, they have lasers as well. And they also have bumpers on them so that they can detect whether they've hit something physically, because sometimes range finders, ultrasonics, lasers and infrared can let you down. So they have bumpers as a sort of last resort to detect whether it's physically hit something. And the bumper has to be the entirety of the surface of the robot, because it could hit any part of it, and we want to make sure that we can stop it if it's hit something. So as I say, it's battery powered. They usually have about half an hour's worth of battery power in them so that they can do a cleaning cycle. And they're not actually guaranteed to clean the entire room, which is something I find surprising. And they store the dirt inside a little storage box, a little vacuum cleaner bag, but it's essentially like a tray that you can slide in and out. And then they can then locate the charge station once they finish their cleaning cycle, and then go back and get some charge for next time it's going to be operated. The more expensive varieties have another cleaning storage device in the charge base, so it looks like kind of a shoe shape, and it will take the dirt and store it in another thing, so you can take it from that away to your garbage can to get rid of the dirt. So it'll clean the robot, so the robot never actually holds it on the more expensive versions. And you can see there on the little diagram, we've got a number of range finders. There's an auto clean program button you can just press and it'll therefore start right away. And we've got bumpers on both sides, front and back. So if I just hold this thing up, let's have a look at this. So we've got the button there. It's always satisfying to do that, isn't it? And we have a number of other things as well. This is the charging and on-off thing. And we can see there we've got the bumper. And there isn't a bumper on the back because it's only when it's going forwards that the bumper has to come into operation. It does have a number of other things I can see on here. So it has three, looks like old light LED, what would we call it? Ultraviolet rangefinder, so it can detect if something is there or not. And there's another one at the top there, and then there's another one on the other side, just there. So that can detect whether it's going over stairs and about to fall down, and also whether it's over a floor or not. These wheels also are quite spring-loaded, so it can adjust to the environment. And I believe inside this, or there's another one that was really satisfying things to peel off. There's also a number of other ultraviolet ones, I think, in there as well. Doesn't look like it has any ultrasonic that I can see. So let's just put that back in there for a second, get back to our slides. Okay, so operating this, so they usually have the simple versions have a simple random movement, and they will just move around. I've got a little animation here to show you that, move around the room without really having any kind of plan. They just move from area to area, and the idea is if you leave this going for half an hour, it should probably have covered every area in that room just randomly. So a random walk, as they would call it. More complex versions will have a laser sensor. So I've got a laser sensor just here, the one that we used for the other robot when we were looking at Roz. And this thing spins around, and on the front there is a little laser beam comes out of there, and there is a little sensor that will detect it. So I think it comes out of that one actually, and that's the sensor. And this thing just spins around and just sends serial data about what it can see distance wise, and then that gets fed into a mapping SLAM, I think they call it, which detects where it is, and also what the environment looks like. So simultaneous location and mapping is SLAM. So yes, more complex versions have that. I don't believe this one does. It doesn't look like it has anything on it that could house such a thing. And also price-wise, these are about £100 to buy. So if this was about that price, it's unlikely that it's got that in it as well. So this one is more likely to just randomly bounce off things for a given amount of time. Now it does come with a remote control, so you can override that. Again, there's more of that. Surely there must be a word for this. and yes, it looks like we can... if the battery's in there. No, I need to put some batteries in, which it comes with. And then we can program it from here. So we can do things like press a home button. I assume that means it will go home. We've got an auto mode, and we have some backwards and forwards. And we can also do things like connect it to our Wi-Fi. So we'll have a look at some of the connectivity. And I'm thinking about, how do we hack this? How do I plug this into my MQTT server and enable it to be able to do things like... you know, when I want it I don't have to use remote control, I can just send a message or have it on a schedule, but through the MQTT server. So I want to know, do you have a robot vacuum cleaner in your house? Is that something that you have? I'm really interested to know if you do. Have you got the Roomba version, or have you got the cheap knockoff version like I've got? Sorry, D-Bot. so yes, what else we've seen here? So once the time is up, the battery is low, or the dirt is storage is full, it will return to the base station. So I need to put the base station down somewhere. So I've got the base station. If I just grab this out of the box, just open this out. So this is what our base station looks like. There is two metal contacts there, and the robot, I assume, has two metal contacts underneath. Yes. So underneath there is two metal contacts there. So when this thing runs over those little contacts just there, like so, it will begin charging. So I'm interested to know how it knows where that is. I've just found the batteries as well for the remote control in the box. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So yes, functions and features. Automatic charging. So Wi-Fi enabled. It can connect to Amazon Alexa or Google Home for voice operation. So if it can do that, that means it has an API, and we can hack that API. That's something I'm interested in looking at. and the return to base station for charging. I'm interested to know how it does that. It will need to have some kind of signal that it can spin round and see. So it probably is at the exact same height, and it may well just be a flashing sequence of pulses. And when it detects that, it knows to sort of home in on that. But it must be quite directional. There must be a way that it knows, rather than just that there is a flashing light in front of it, precisely where, and it needs to turn itself until it's completely aligned with that and then drive towards it. So I'm interested to see how that works. And then it has this thing, they call it smart motion. I would say it's actually the opposite of that. So this N79S thoroughly cleans a room through an advanced cleaning path. It's just random motion. So in this way, it cleans effective cleaning is achieved through multiple passes, and that's the get out there. So if it hasn't actually done it through random motion the first time, it'll probably get it the next time. But you may well end up with like zigzags of clean bits and dirt islands in the rest of the room, perhaps. Cool. And next is the three-stage cleaning system for effective cleanliness. I've took all this from the website, if you can't tell. So they say it has a V-shaped main brush. So I just grab that out of the box there. This is what it's talking about. These are the little whiskery things, and they will go underneath, and they will sort of just flick around like so. And they can get edges, they can go underneath things, and they can just lift more dirt from the carpet. The main cleaning is done by the rotary thing underneath. And we can have a look at that shortly as well. And there is an app. Of course there's an app. So I've downloaded the app, but I've not paired it because I've actually not switched this on yet. I have been saving this for the unboxing today. So this, is it called Dbot Home, I think? Dbot. There we go. Oops. So I did install this before the show, but I've actually not played with it yet. I think you have to pair it with it. So there we go. So there is an app, and it enables you, once you've switched it on, I think it goes into kind of like a pairing mode. I don't know whether it uses Bluetooth or whether it uses something else, but yeah, we need to look at that. So keep your eye on that one, Alex, that keeps popping up. It may well be something we need to kick off. So what it says on here is the N79S is compatible with Alexa, Amazon Echo while being compiled. Can't speak today, while being controlled via the app, and you can double smart your home credentials by using one of these centralized systems to maintain your and direct your Dbot. That's just dreadful marketing, maybe from somebody with second language is English perhaps. Double your smart credentials. I mean, I don't think, who cares really? If you've got a dirty house, people care about that. So yes, it has stair safety technology, which again is just a couple of ultraviolet distance sensors to see is there something underneath it or not. If there's nothing underneath it, it's probably reached the end of some stairs. So you'd hope that the internal reading of these and turning of the motors is quick enough to detect that it's gone to the edge of some steps. In this room, there's not any steps, so that's not going to be a problem. I'm probably not going to operate it in an environment where there are them, but it can safely move around your home using anti-drop sensors to clean around the stairs. And they do appear to be this infrared. Cool, cool. So obstacle detection technology. So it has a bumper if all else fails, but it's also got this anti-collision sensors and soft cushion bumpers, and it can avoid obstacles, protect your furniture. So yeah, this is essentially going to just go in random different motions. If it detects something either by the bumper or by the rangefinders, it will back off, spin round, and then just go off in another random direction, probably at least 90 degrees from the surface that it's met. The logic I would certainly use. We shall see it in action shortly. And then this one did tickle me. The find me option. So to help users find when Dbot is stuck in some hidden area, like under the, like in corners or under furniture. So yeah, when it gets stuck under the couch, this is how you can find it. You can just hear it grinding its gears underneath your couch and hopefully not setting on fire. So if you like what I do and you want to see more of this kind of stuff, not necessarily this stuff, but more of the robot stuff that we usually do, then give me a like, give me a comment and subscribe to the channel. And we do go live every single Sunday at 7 PM GMT-ish. So yeah, it's always 7 o'clock, but it's just the time zone when we're in British summertime. It can be that hour later or earlier. I can't remember which. And you can also follow me on social media. So Alex will post the link to all the different social media links. You can go over to sparsfan.com/about/linkinbio to see a list of them, which is a bit easier to click. And you can also join our mailing list as well. So we do have a mailing list which is available, and Alex will post a link to that as well. Okay, so what else have we got on here? Let's go to the proper unboxing then, shall we? Okay, so I just need to move my microphone over here a bit as well. So yes, here is the robot itself. I'm just going to flip this over and have a look what we have here. Doesn't look like we have to plug the battery in. It looks like the battery is already there. I can see that's the dirt box. I don't know how you actually open it. There we go. There's a little button there you press to open it. And it appears to have, it's got a filter in there, I can see. I open that up. Like so. It has a filter module in there that you can change occasionally. And it's got a smallish size there as well for the dirt to be stored in. So we can put that back in like so. There's the main rollers that are going to brush against the carpet. Let's get that bit there to shot. I'm going to brush against the carpet there. And we've got the main wheels, which are on these sort of springs. And there's that roller ball just to stop it falling on its face. And they're the two charging elements too. So then on the side, we've got this sort of visor area there. It's the whole thing is a physical bumper. And then underneath, there is these two squares that we can put these on, I guess. I don't know if there's a particular orientation these need to be in. Maybe just like so. And what else have we got on here? There's a little tool there for brushing and untangling it. Quite a useful thing to have. And we've got the dock, and we've also got the charger as well. And I think that's all the components from there. Put that back down there for a second. I'll shove that out the way for a second. Okay, so it's not very heavy. Interesting to know. And the charging module's got more of that lovely stuff to undo. Yeah, and I reckon in there, it's got another one of these visors. I don't know if you can see that with the lighting. One of these, there we go, we can see there. Plastic sort of covers, and that's probably got infrared in there that pulses out a signal to say this is where the base station is. So I'm guessing what we do there, plug in power to this. We had a power outage the other weekend, and it made me think. Got that camera for a second. It made me think about what kind of redundancy we need to have in the robot lab. So I've got a great big UPS under the desk here that powers the Wi-Fi and some of the equipment here, and I've also got another UPS right where the router is for the house, where the broadband comes in. Because that would, if that's got power, that can transmit the broadband, and the phone line's unlikely to go out in the event of a power outage. There is always power to your phone line, so you can make emergency calls. And we've also got a switch in the loft, so there's another UPS in there. So there's three UPSs all in total, providing a battery backup. Right, so I'm just going to go back to the overhead again. I'm just going to plug this in like so. I've got two options here. There is actually, so there's obviously a charger connector there, so we can plug in the dock, but you can actually plug that directly into the robot as well, just like so. Is the audio okay now? Somebody said audio just got worse. Is that because I'm not directly looking at the microphone? It's really directional, this microphone, so if I'm not completely in front of it, you might hear me go a bit quiet. So just keep me posted on that. Just going to move some of the things out the way and plug this in. Okay, so that's now plugged in. And I'm powering it up. I'm just putting my hands there just in case anything happens, like it shoots off the desk. Doesn't look like it, but that is glowing. I don't know if you can see that. Yeah. Thanks, George. Okay, so if I press that, is it going to start moving about? I don't know how much power this has actually got if I remove it. It looks like it's got some juice. So So what I'm going to do, I'm going to put this on the floor. I'm going to go to another camera view, which is the, that's Alex's feet there. And I'm just going to put this on the floor like so. And it looks like it's flashing ready to receive some kind of command. So I've got the remote control here as well. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to press the auto button. And it made a little noise. And there it goes. So what's it going to do? Underneath that area there, it should detect that, hopefully. You might also hear it grinding all the dirt off the floor as well. There's probably quite a bit of dirt on this floor. You can see there's a little bit there. Now, interestingly, that carpet is quite thick. I purposely bought that type of carpet because it's soundproofed. Thick carpeting is really good if you've got a YouTube studio for capturing sound, so you've not got lots of echoes and bouncing. So you can see there, it is doing that random path. It's right near me now. And it's just gone off screen for a second. It's just underneath there. It is just doing again. So there doesn't seem to be any logic at all to the path that it's taking. It's just hitting an area and then going off in a kind of random angle. Not the same angle each time as well, interestingly. It's just going to hit that. There we go. It's just going past Alex's feet. It's going to go off there. Now, will it be able to get back on there? Yep, it's not having any trouble with that at all. Cool. I'm gonna turn that off again now because I'm sure you don't want to watch it cleaning my entire floor. That's really not entertaining, is it? So what I'm going to do, I'm just looking at the buttons to press. I'm just going to press that auto button again. And that does indeed seem to be stop. Now, it might be trying to find a charger. So let's put the charger so that it can find it. Let's just... it gets stuck in that edge there. Let's press the home button and see if it can find home. There we go. So press the home button. So it should find, if it can. There we go. Yep, it's moving towards the charger. It's correcting itself all the time, so it needs to get those two connectors to be completely aligned. It's doing a really good job of that. And then it can just put itself into place. Fantastic. So that works exactly as we would expect it to work, I guess. For me, that's really novel. It does mean I can just leave this to tidy last thing at night. So first thing in the morning, I've got a nice clean studio to come to. I just need to make sure I remember to empty it every now and again. And I need somewhere to put the charging station. I might well put it underneath the chair, actually, where Alex's feet are there. There's a little area it could probably just live underneath there. Yes, so that's the cleaning element. There's a little... blade on that, actually. That's interesting. A nice little diagram there of somebody cutting their hand as well, just in case you're an idiot and you need to know not to put your finger on a blade. So some of the other functions it appears to have as well, on the remote control, we've got a little bell. So if you press that, I think you can hear where it is when it's probably turned on. There is a timer button, not sure what that one does. There's another home button there with an S, and then there is a Wi-Fi button just there, and then there's another button there which I don't know what that does. So I'm going to read the instructions and figure out. It's a pretty hefty instruction manual. It's probably in several languages. Yeah, it looks like it. And they've also got some diagrams in there similar to the one I drew about the smart, I'm trying to do this in reverse, the smart operation there as well. So yeah, we're thinking about what to name this. Has somebody come up with a decent name there, Alex? Pac-Man. That's an awesome thing. I was thinking, what do we need to stick on it? It needs to have a name, doesn't it? You can't have a robot without a name. So yes, I'm interested to know what people think there. Names-wise, I think Richard may have won that. For sure. What else was I going to talk to you about as well about this robot? I think that was pretty much it on there, to be honest. So yeah, do you have a robot vacuum cleaner? That's what I'm interested to know. If you're watching this live, I want to know now. If you're watching this on replay, paste in the comments if you've got one of them, or kind of what model you've got, and tell me if it's got any advanced feature that this one doesn't have, such as the SLAM mapping as well. Awesome. So yes, I wanted to talk to you as well about clustered Pi. So You might have seen in a couple of videos ago, I was talking about building a Raspberry Pi cluster, and I wanted to do a really nice design for some Raspberry Pi Zeros. But before I did that, I really needed to build a standard cluster to figure out how clustering works and learn some of the techniques around that. So I have been following Jeff Geerling's videos about using Ansible and Raspberry Pis. I think he had a couple of Raspberry Pi 4s, and then he turned to Turing Pi, which was like a motherboard with some compute modules from Raspberry Pi. And I wanted to do a similar kind of thing. I have built one in the past, but I haven't really returned to it since then. I didn't really understand how to do that. Now, if you've got a number of Raspberry Pis and you want to make sure they're always up to date and they all have the same software on them, you could log into them individually, but that's really, really time consuming and laborious. So you can use scripts to do all this for you. And the video that we looked at last time about Ansible, we looked at how we can create some scripts to do exactly that. So I've been building out Clustered Pi, and the goals I had in mind there was that it could run Docker, and Docker would enable us to run these software containers, and we can run them on any of the nodes, it doesn't matter which. We could run something called Portainer to manage those nodes in a graphical user interface, and I love Portainer. We wanted to install MongoDB. So when I do the project on the Twitcher Pi, which I think it's just out of camera shot, but it's that thing that's just there. Twitcher Pi is a Raspberry Pi Zero with a camera module installed, and we're going to point that outside one of the windows of the house just here. If I go to that shot, it's just sort of that way there, this window. So we're going to point the camera out of the window at a bird table, and I have a bird table that I've not installed that's just inside the room just here. And then once we've got that in place, we can start taking some pictures of birds at the bird table and then building up our AI model from that. So the software I'll be writing for Twitcher Pi will enable us to do that. But before we do that, I wanted to make sure our Clustered Pi could serve a website so that we could host some files to capture things like that and have some information about the project. And part of the project was to learn how to do that. So we're using Docker to host those containers, Portainer to manage those containers in a nice user interface, MongoDB to store the Twitcher Pi data, Mosquito as a MQTT broker, and we're going to use Node-RED to do some visualization of that with a dashboard. We're going to host the files, the web files, using Nginx, which is a nice JavaScript-based web server, and we're also going to use Jekyll to build a website from Markdown files. So I've done all that. I've now got a new website, which is called Clustered Pi. I'm just going to grab a browser and show you what Clustered Pi looks like. I can just grab the right screen there. Okay. I'm going to show you what that looks like. So let me just type in clusteredpi.com. You can share the link if you want there, Alex, as well in the chat. So if I go over to here, so this is what Clustered Pi looks like. And you can see there www.clustered-pi.com is the website. And these files that you're seeing here are being hosted from this little cluster that's just here. You can probably just see a few lights flicker in there. So there's four Raspberry Pis that's being served just from there. Okay, let's go back to there. And on here, what I've done is I put you a picture of what those four look like. So this Raspberry Pi on the end here, this one had a faulty memory card slot. In fact, it snapped off entirely, so there was no way for it to actually boot. And I read up, you can boot from USB. So it's currently got this little purple USB stick with the memory card that it did have in it, just in there, boots fine. I've then got another three Raspberry Pi 4 nodes. Now they've actually all got different sizes of memory. I think one's got 1 gig, 2 gig, 4 gig, and 8 gig. That's not for any particular reason by design. That's just how I bought them when they were released. And this is what we're eventually going for. So there's a number of Raspberry Pis here, which are the Raspberry Pi Zero. And I want to use the Raspberry Pi Zero 2 because it's obviously a lot quicker. So I do have a number of Raspberry Pis. You can just see them here. So I think these ones here are all the, oh, that's just a standard Raspberry Pi. So maybe it's these ones here. Yeah, that's the Raspberry Pi. If you can see that, Raspberry Pi 2 with the big silver chip on there. So there's a number of them. I think all of them are Raspberry Pis. I've got the camera really high up today because when the flap opens up, it needs plenty of room. So the camera is like way, way up here. There we go. So we've got a number of Raspberry Pi 2s. And the rest of them are just Raspberry Pi Zeros, like so. So yeah, one of the challenges is powering this. So I've ordered a ton of official Raspberry Pi chargers. And that'll mean that we can plug them all in. And one of the things that people talked about we could have is this little area here. If I flip this around this way, these little USB power and USB connectors will actually be inside that tunnel. So we can route all the wires down that tunnel and then just out the back. So that's what we're going to do on there. So that's the page there. It talks about what is Raspberry Pi. There's a link there to the YouTube playlist of all the different clustered Pi videos. And then it does say at the moment, Raspberry Pis are in short supply. You can get some of them, particularly the starter kits, which have got a bit more to them. I've also got all the social links there as well and a bit of a sitemap. And then we have an about page, which just talks about all the different components that are running on there. And then more importantly, the build log. So I've been creating a number of articles over the past couple of days. So there's one about the hardware overview. So it talks about how much it costs to build one of these. I was quite shocked at how much that costs in totality. But I didn't buy all that at once. This has been bought over a number of probably years, to be honest. So the Raspberry Pi 4s, I bought them one at a time. I always pick up a SD card when I'm in the supermarket. I usually get the extreme version of the SanDisk ones. I recently bought a network hub as well and some nice colourful Cat6 cables. I did also buy these USB A to USB C charging cables, which are really short. So they are really, really short cables. Now the problem with that is the plug that I bought to plug these into, it says it can deliver 3.1 amps per USB port. That might be true, but only one of them can have that much power at a time, I believe, because we have run into this issue where it just underpowers and the Raspberry Pis reboot. They just get a low power situation. Sorry, I've got a really dry throat here. And then the USB charger itself, so this is kind of what it looks like. I don't think this is the exact one I've got, but it's a very similar kind of model. And this has got, it says that it can deliver 4.4 amps, but I think in reality it's like 1 amp per channel, and that's just not enough for Raspberry Pi 4s. They need a good 2 and a bit amps, I think. So yeah, I wouldn't recommend them, but that's what I've currently got on there, and I've got two official chargers as well. And then, yeah, just Raspberry Pi's set up. We install Raspberry Pi OS on the SD card using the imager. I've called them nodes 1, 2, 3, and 4. I use the network hub and cables just to sort of wire everything up. There's the nice colourful cables there. And then power-wise, like I said, I'm just using the two official chargers and that plug. Excuse me. So then we have, I've got a UPS, like I said, that's the great big thing that's under my desk here. So I think three of them are surge protectors and three of them are actually battery backed. That's just to provide a bit of redundancy in case there's an issue. So that's the hardware overview. And then I've been working on the software overview as well, all the different components, the Ansible files that make this up. The Docker and Docker Compose setup. Give some examples there, and also Portainer. And then on the other one, I put what is Docker and a pretty big overview of the commands that we need to run to get Docker up and running. So all this software is running on that Raspberry Pi cluster. It's self-hosted, and what's really cool is if I go to GitHub, so I'm on my Mac, I'm updating, I'm creating a markdown file, I can then publish that to the live site in a number of seconds. I can show you that now, actually. So if I go to Visual Studio over here, and what I'm going to do, I have been messing with some of these other files. Maybe I'll just need to stash them before I do that. So if I just stash that, and if I go over, in fact, let's undo those changes because we don't need them. I don't want it pushing changes that I've not approved yet. So that's what I'm doing there. Right, so I'm going to come over here and I'm going to go to my web folder. And in the web folder, I'm going to go to the about page and I'm going to create a new secret one that we're going to call secret.md for Markdown. And what I'm going to do now, if I open this file up, let's open this up over, oops, to this window here. Let's just close out the others. There we go. So the first thing we need to do is three dashes, and that tells Jekyll that this is a front matter. And we'll give it a title, so we'll call this a secret page. I'm also going to give this a layout, which is the kind of template that we're using. So I'm going to call this one, what should we call this one? Let's just go with the default page for now. And then I'm just going to say, hello, this is our secret page. And what we can also do is we can do, if we do this pound symbol, oops, I pressed the wrong button there. If we do the pound symbol, or if in the UK you call that a hash, and we just do a title, so let's just do hello. What that will look like, we could even view this in Visual Studio by clicking over here. It will look through the Markdown, so you can see there that that hash means that it's a like a heading one. If we did two hashes, we get a slightly smaller three. One, we also get that little underline as well, and then we've got the this is a secret page. And we can do like a web link as well. If we did something like apple.com, that will then appear as a clickable link, like so. So that's now a clickable link. So there's loads of stuff you can do with Markdown. It's one of my favorite ways of creating pages. And what's going to happen is Jekyll is going to read this page. It's going to come to the layout and go, all right, I understand what the layout is. There is a layout section here. There's something that's called default. It will render this default page. So there's some HTML. It will look at the page title in these little squiggly brackets. That's something called Ginger 2. And the page title is what we've just created in our secret file where we did that title tag there. So secret page will be replaced. That variable will be replaced with what's in there. So it'll then apply all that styling, all that CSS cascading style sheets and make this page look really nice. So let's publish this. I'll show you how we do this. So I'm over here. Let me just get to the right folder. I'm in Clustered Pi. You can go to clusteredpi.com and download this yourself. I just need to push that change out there. So I'm just going to get rid of anything that we don't need from here. We want that change. We don't want any of the other changes. So do we just revert them back? Yeah, let's delete them. We just want the secret. There we go. And then I'm going to push this up to GitHub. Just doing sync changes. That's important because what will happen is when we run this Ansible script, it will tell all four of the Docker nodes to grab the latest version of Clustered Pi from GitHub, download the files, and then it will spin up a Jekyll instance. Jekyll will then do what we've just seen on here, where it'll render the page. And then it will publish those changes to our live website. So let's do this. If we do, so I think it's Ansible playbook. We provide an inventory file. We provide a playbook, which is our Nginx playbook. And we then say that this user is the Raspberry Pi user. I think that's the right command. So what it's going to do, it's going to gather some facts. it's connected to all four of the nodes there, which is good. It's now cloned Git on all four of those nodes. And if you watch that website, if you go to clustered-pi.com, you'll see it momentarily go offline. I can probably write a much cleverer script that takes each node down one at a time, applies the change, and then brings them up so that the entire website doesn't go down. But if I go over my phone now to Clustered Pi, at the moment I'm getting bad gateway, and that's because currently this is offline. And if I just move that widget there, you can say it's bringing up my app. So once it's brought up the page, it's then updated it with our secret page, and we can navigate to that shortly. And it just takes it a couple of seconds because what it's doing in bringing it up, it's building out that entire site, all those different pages, converting them from Markdown files, applying our template, and then creating the website from that. But I love the fact that this is so reliable to do this. You can just make a change, deploy it very quickly, and it's all automated. Could even schedule this to happen once a day So it just brings down the website in an evening, maybe change out one node at a time. And it's using Nginx, and Nginx enables us to load balance the four web servers. So when you hit a web server, you're getting one of the four nodes. And that means that we've got some redundancy there if one of the nodes gets taken offline. So it's brought up one and two. So let's just try the website out now and see. Yep, that's now loading up. So if we now go, I'll let that carry on loading up all four nodes in the background. But while it's doing that, let's jump back over to here. We can give this a refresh. And if I now go to slash about, we didn't create any navigation to this. But if we do secret.html, we've now got that page that we created with all the different headings and so on. And there's that link to Apple that we created. That's how easy it is to maintain your own website using Jekyll, Nginx, Docker, Portainer, and all the rest of it. Very, very nice and simple. I just love how quickly, and because it's static web pages, it's quite invulnerable to web attacks, because you're not actually running something like PHP in the background. It's just being served up on Nginx, which is pretty solid. So let's go back to Visual Studio. Yeah, it's just taking a bit longer on some of the other nodes there, but we can see the website's live. So this is what I love. This is one of the major updates I've made to Clustered Pi in the background. And now that I've got that working, it means I can then switch focus back onto Twitcher Pi and build out some content for that, host that on here as well. And yeah, that means that we've got another couple of them up and running. So really pleased with how that's going. I'll keep you posted on that. And I'll also be working on the Raspberry Pi Zero version of that as well, which means that we can run this a lot cheaper than that £404 it is to build the cluster. So we don't need to have a network switch. We don't need to have all the cables and everything. We just need the USB power cable and the Raspberry Pi Zero itself. Pretty much it. Cool. So let's go over to the chat. So if you're watching this on replay, this is the section of the video where we will sort of say goodbye for now, and if you're watching on the live, we'll carry on and do a bit of a Q&A as well.